underneath an overpass. We go to this slum area, and about as wide as this building here, there was a river of sludge. Now, I'm not talking muddy water. I'm talking thick sludge, bubbling in places, you know, garbage everywhere. And we had to pull a raft over across this sludge river. So we cross this river, and on the other side, it backs up, so the river's on one side, and then the overpass on the other side. Whenever I think overpass, I think big, you know, overpass, right? You could live under there, that kind of thing. This thing, at the very highest, was about 5 feet off the ground, and that's where about 200 people lived, in between this river of sludge and this overpass. They lived there, little shanties along in the spaces there in between. Now, why in the world would people ever live in a situation like that? Well, this particular slum dwelling is known for being very violent. Criminals, if you're running from the law, nobody's going to cross the river of sludge to get to you if you're running from the law. So it's a very, very rough place. No one was able to do ministry. Now, this story actually happened a few years ago, just to give you context, that it was to this community of outlaws, that Ibu Hana was trying to do ministry. Actually, there was a pastor who was trying to do ministry there, and he was not able to. And he got in contact with Ibu Hana, and they went to this community to give out some rice. And whenever they got there, there was a man drunk, picked up a huge knife, and ran off. Literally, tried to kill that pastor. Don't ever come back here again. Ran him off. So they let a little time pass. And then Ibu Hana, who is our partner with Operation Christmas Child, made shoeboxes available through this pastor. So the pastor used that opportunity to go to this slum area, and he just outside of the slum area, and made invitation to the parents inside of the community. Please come to this event, take part. We want to bless your children. So they did. They went. They received the gift boxes, and then all of a sudden things started to change. For the first time, the community leaders started to invite them to do other outreaches. You know, okay, well, maybe you're not all that bad. We'll take some of the rice that you have to offer us. We'll do this program that you're wanting us to do. And just over time, this was more than a year that they continued ministry in that community. Well, I got the privilege of going to this place. I got there and I was embraced by the pastor of the church that's now meeting under the bridge there in Surabaya. He showed me, you know, the different parts of the community. It's getting better. It's getting healthier. I mean, they're still living there. It's still rough. But I'm told that it's a world different than what it was before. I went to one place where the bridge is higher. They have a church set up there so that you have to bend down. You go inside. But then once you sit there, it's comfortable. You know, it's like sitting on a bus. You got a little space. And they cram in there. And once or twice a week, they raise that overpass. Praising the Lord. Now, that man who embraced me whenever I got to that village was none other than the same man who greeted that pastor all those years ago with a knife and said, "If you come back here, I will kill you." Operation Christmas Child can be a key to unlock some of the most secure doors in some of the darkest places in the world.